On today's episode of Six Pack Cinema, we will be rating and reviewing Rocket Man, a musical fantasy about the fantastical human story of Elton John's breakthrough years.
Dude, you should move.
Yes.
Okay, I've had a couple, so.
Movie review.
Hello and welcome to Six Pack Cinema. Thank you for joining. Either you just saw Rocket Man and you're dying to hear what people thought of it, so you searched the podcast apps and you found us, or you're a repeat customer and we appreciate both of you. Thank you for joining. My name's Jimmy. I'm joined, as always, by John and Dave. We will be discussing Rocket Man, Elton John movie.
Rocket Man.
I'm a Rocket Man. How it works here is we are going to give our gut reactions, then we are going to rate. No, then we are going to discuss what we liked, didn't like, things we'd change, just our general thoughts. Then we're going to give it our ratings, two-pronged rating. One, entertainment. Two is critical scale. Let's get into it. Let's go with Dave. What's your gut reaction to this movie?
I love this movie. It was everything to Elton John that I wish Bohemian Rhapsody had been to Freddie Mercury.
Okay. All right. Solid.
It's a fair assessment.
Solid. Concise.
Very concise.
John?
I liked it. It was really good. I kind of felt a little off with the dramatics of the it felt like I was watching a play and they would dip into like song and dance, which is awesome. I like that, but it confused me sometimes. So I was like, what the hell is really going on here? Is he really floating? Is this really like, I don't know.
I think we can safely say no, he wasn't really floating.
He might have been. Floating.
They made it look like the whole crowd would have jumped in the air for like 5 feet. And I don't know if that was real.
It wasn't.
That's not how physics works.
It wasn't real.
No. No, I get that. But I'm just saying it went a little bit. I loved it. It was great. But if I had to pick on one thing, I was like, that was a little weird. Like, they had to tone that back or at least like snap out of it quickly to make it realize that like this is like a moment or a flashback or whatever, you know?
Yeah.
Looking for a cinematic breakup, call that.
Okay. Interesting. I went into this movie expecting to love it because I love Elton John and I love musical biopics. And then it was nothing like I expected it to be, but I really enjoyed it, and I think it's one of the more daring movies I've seen in a while.
I'll agree with it was daring for sure.
Yeah, so that's my gut reaction. To delve further is when I didn't like the movie that much until he met Bernie, and then that journey started. All the childhood stuff, and when they were doing the musical of like Saturday Nights when he was a kid, I was like, oh no. I'm going to be let down, huh? Because I was so excited for it, and that just didn't do, like, anything for me. I thought it was, like, Hairspray-esque, like, just, like...
Which song was that? Was that the one where, like, he aged throughout the song?
Yes. Yeah.
Oh, I actually loved that whole sequence and how he would, like, get older throughout the song.
See, like, that was one of the bigger ones I had an issue with.
And stuff. I might
like it on a rewatch, knowing that I'm getting into a a fantastical movie. I might like it more, but I didn't know that's the movie I was getting into until that all happened.
I think that's partly because you like turn off trailers.
Yeah, I don't
like,
watch
when
trailers.
Because the movie's been advertised as like not a straight biopic, as like a musical fantasy about Elton John's life.
But I didn't think it was going to be like that much.
They
turned the dial up like to 11, which is cool. I mean, in hindsight, like Jimmy said, rewatch, like knowing what I'm getting, I'd probably enjoy it much better, but there was a moment that I was like, what the fuck is going on? Is he playing piano? Is he dancing now? Is he a singer walking throughout the bar? What's going on here? Also, was he 13 in a bar with bar fights? That was weird. I had questions.
I mean, you can legally drink at 16, so that didn't seem that weird.
Well, he's 13, Dave. 3 years too young.
But I was a little turned off, but it was like a moment where I was like, oh, okay. Changed my whole mindset. This isn't going to be what I thought. And then when he met Bernie, from there on out, I loved the entire movie.
Yeah, so, like, the one thing I wrote down that I wanted to touch on, and I'm going to try and, like, limit the comparisons to Bohemian Rhapsody, even though, like, everyone on the internet is, and it's just the nature of two big 70s and 80s stars having biopics come out so close to each other. But I like that this told the story it was going to tell through the music instead of, like, Bohemian Rhapsody. The story was about making the music. I think that's a lot less interesting than telling the story of the artist and just using the music as, like, moments in his life.
Man, that's, like, a great thought process, because that is everything I want in biopics is behind the scenes. Tell me how they made the songs and, like, what inspired the meanings of the songs. And that's why I didn't like Bohemian Rhapsody, because I came away from it like, oh, their songs are about nothing. They just made songs they thought people...
Like, they made it to just make it commercially appealing. So
yes, they were just, they were not personal songs. They were just commercial appeal. But you're right. This one, it didn't put any of that in. It actually faked it. Like, the Pirate Smile song, they just, like, shoehorned that into an area. And then the Rocket Man, when he's, like, in the pool, and they made it like it was this personal song about his struggles, when it's not. Bernie Taupin has said, like, I just was daydreaming about what does a guy, an astronaut in space alone, think about.
Yeah. But then they just took his song and made it about personal moments in his life.
Yeah. So it's different than this whole biopic was different than I normally like, but I dug it. It was a trip.
And I think the good thing about that is, like, they were out of order. Like, obviously this kid wasn't singing Saturday Night in a Bar when he's 13 years old, but you forgave that because of, like, the fantastical, like, appeal of it. It was at no point are you, like, going to fact check these things. Like, with Bohemian Rhapsody, you were appalled at the end to find out these things were, like, so fucked up in timeline.
Yeah, because you're not going to fact check this, because they never present it as this is 100% factual, which is cool.
Which was the better way to go.
Well, it's daring.
For this one, it is.
There is a cookie cutter way to do biopics. That, I mean, you go watch any of, even Walk the Line, which is one of my favorite movies about Johnny Cash, is a cookie cutter formula for how to do a biopic. And Bohemian Rhapsody made the most cookie cutter movie you could ever possibly make. And this is the same director, right? Or the director of this?
The director of this is the guy who took over for Bohemian Rhapsody in, like, the last few months of shooting, because Bryan Singer wasn't showing up.
Yeah. I knew there was a connection somehow, but this was daring and bold and kind of like a risk, and it was cool. I thought it paid off.
So, how do you feel about Taron Egerton?
I'd never seen him in anything before.
I thought he was fantastic. He doesn't get the same, like, award love that Rami got, it's going to be such a damn shame. And he won't, just because it's two similar roles, one right after each other. So they're not going to, like, nominate this again. But I think he portrayed Elton much better than Rami did Freddie.
Absolutely. Because in the middle of the movie, I forgot this is the kid from the Kingsman or Eddie the Eagle. I was like, this is Elton.
Yes.
He made you believe he was Elton.
For sure.
I think I only took a couple notes, but one was I love the facial expressions he made. Like, when he wasn't even talking, just kind of his reactions. Like, at one point, no one listening will see this. One point, he just kind of did like a... And I was, it was just, they would make me laugh more than words.
He scrunched his face.
Like, the first thing that hit me was in the beginning when he was, like, sitting down talking about his addictions and, like, how he was listing them off. He had, like, certain facial tics for each addiction.
Oh, and I loved that whole sequence. He comes in dressed up like the devil, and the more you know, the more you find out about him, the more you're getting into his story, he takes off pieces of it.
Until he's like, down to a bare bathroom. Than everyone else. Yeah.
That was beautiful. I like that.
As he's, like, bearing his soul, he's undressing.
Rips
physically.
The horns off, then the cape's behind him. I love that.
It's not subtle, but it's still done awesome.
I noticed it, so it's not subtle.
Man, I liked it. The guy that played Bernie, he was in a show I liked on AMC
Jamie Bell.
Turn. Is that his name? I don't know his name.
Yeah. See, I thought he was, for a while there, I thought he was Hickey from The Terror.
Yeah.
Oh, a little bit.
I was wrong.
Yeah.
But throughout the Terror.
I'm kind of interested in how much is factual. Like, the marriage was funny.
Yeah.
Which one? His marriage or his parents' marriage?
His
marriage.
The entire thing took up, like,
five minutes of screen time. They cut back to the AA meeting, and they're like, "How did you like Marriage?" And he's like, "It was bad. I'm gay."
Yeah,
that was good.
What? How about his parents? I have one note from this, and so it just simply said that Elton John was a bitch. He's already admitted that he's a bitch. After the fact, the reason he chose Taron Egerton to do this because he wanted him to do it the real way. He wanted him to come off as like a nasty, bitchy guy. So he did.
Was that but to do with I, his parents? I felt like his parents.
Because I feel like his parents, that's how someone describes their parents if they're a bitch. Those people were caricatures of parents. I do not believe they were that bad. I mean, they're bad, probably. They're probably very bad. But
from the limited research I've done, it's pretty spot on to how they were.
Well, the limited research you've done is from Elton John's mouth, which I'm sure has some validity to it, but it was just presented in such a way of, like, way over the top, just like everything else in this movie was over the top.
There were moments where it was too cliche, or...
Like, the "when are you gonna hug me" stuff, I assume he didn't actually say that when he was a kid.
Yeah.
What about when she said, "you'll never be loved properly"? Like, come on.
Yeah. I'm sure they, like, insinuated that. I doubt they just blatantly said it. Yeah. But also, like, when he goes to his dad's house and his dad has the whole second family, that hit me as probably, like, a very real thing. That most
I believe that. But, I mean, his father had PTSD from Vietnam. That's clear, right?
I don't think it was Vietnam.
Oh, well, whatever war he came back from. Because he came back from it and he was a different person.
Korea.
Well, yeah, Korea makes sense, that timeline. But, I mean, PTSD, that the guy was fucked up. You know, he tore his life apart. He had to start over. I get that. It's just a shame that, you know, Elton, his son, was Reginald, was a victim. So it sucks. But, like I said, it felt like it was way over the top. So I gotta give shout out to his parents. Like, hey, I don't think you were that bad.
No, you're just saying that because you have a kid, and you know she's going to say something similar about you one day.
She's going to love me.
I thought this was, like, a fantastical driven movie. And Elton John's character was good. Bernie Taupin's character was good. But everyone else was kind of really just surface level written. Like the music executive that he sleeps with and then turns on him. His parents.
Well, did you realize, because that guy was Rob Stark from Game of Thrones. He was playing the same character as Littlefinger played in Bohemian Rhapsody. It's the same guy.
Same guy?
Yeah. John Reed was the manager of both of them. Queen and Elton John.
They should have had that Littlefinger do
that
again.
That's interesting. So I thought that was kind of weak. Like, all the side characters, there's not a lot of surface level to them. Even my favorite actor from Boardwalk Empire, Al Capone, I don't know his real name, but the guy with the cigar, like, everything he said was what a cartoon record executive would say, like, shit, that one's shit too, shit. But
I mean, I guess it kind of plays better because Elton John was supposed to be like a wicked over the top person, so make everyone baseline, you make him a little more deeper, it makes him by comparison look better, right?
For sure. And I think this tend to happen in like biopics where like the main focus is on this one person, so everyone else doesn't really get much development. They're just there to reflect off the central character.
Yeah. Did you, the, like, Our Song, like, I don't know the history behind Our Song, and I really hope that he wrote that for him. Like, I never even thought that Bernie wrote that about this is him and Elton's song.
Never thought about that either.
Yeah, I mean, I hope so, man.
That's how they present it in the movie, right? Like,
yeah.
I'd buy us a house where the two of us can live and work on our music and stuff, and this is our song.
I mean, it makes sense. I never thought of that. I'm not as big
I don't want to fact check because I don't get my heart broken.
You're not a big Elton fan?
No, I am, but I don't want to fact check and find out that was not the case.
What about you, Dave? Are you a big Elton fan?
I like all his songs, but I'm not like, I didn't know a ton about his history.
I wonder if
I love his music, but I don't know him that well.
I wonder if he really, well, like all the songs are Bernie songs, so. But
I didn't know that at all. I didn't know he wasn't a songwriter.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I didn't know that either. And that they've just been best friends.
Oh, Bert.
That was the best line in the whole movie. He's like, what does a kid from what will he do to become a songwriter? Write songs.
Yeah.
Love that.
Bernie.
Just do it, man.
I love Bernie's songs. I think he's one of my favorite songwriters. But he says that his songs don't really have deeper meanings or metaphors. Like, they're pretty all straightforward. Like, Rocket Man is about...
It's about Rocket Man.
Is about an astronaut in space and, like, what would he be thinking? And Tiny Dancer is about his girlfriend at the time. Like, seamstress for the band. She was the seamstress for the band. Married a music man. Bernie was the music man. Like, they're all... There's nothing hidden. There's nothing, like... Let's just put some words together and have people search for meanings. It's like, this is what they are.
Okay. Can I ask you, as an Elton guy, I'm dying to know this. All right, so he played the little riff to Candle in the Wind in his interview. So, I just can't top of my head, right? Did he write that? And did Bernie actually write the lyrics for Candle in the Wind for Diana?
What? No, they just used that for her, I thought.
I thought he rewrote the words for Diana.
I thought he covered it for her.
Oh, okay.
I don't know. I don't know the answer.
See, I thought he did this magnificent song for her at her funeral. I thought that would be nice, but like maybe not. I was giving him too much credit.
Did they change the lyrics for her?
I think so. I thought that much, at least.
Hmm.
Probably, like, now thinking back, it's probably like one word. Probably I'd say Diana somewhere.
Rewritten and re-recorded. Candle in the Wind, 1997, is a song by Bernie and Elton, a rewritten and re-recorded version of their 1974 song, Candle in the Wind.
Okay, so they originally wrote it and then re-released it.
But it's rewritten, too.
Yeah.
So I want to know how many different words are in there.
A couple words, like you said, like her name's probably.
Yeah.
The lyrics of the earlier version of Candle in the Wind, also written by Taupin, were a tribute to Marilyn Monroe. The opening lines of the 1973 version, Goodbye Norma Jean, Though I Never Knew You at All, were adapted to Goodbye England's Rose, May You Ever Grow in Our Hearts. So they changed, like, they subtly changed the lyrics.
All right.
That's fair.
That's fair. Okay, I'll give it to him.
There you go.
Still, it's a beautiful song. I love it.
Yeah, my favorite is the Mad Hatter's song. You know that one? You never seen Almost Famous?
Yeah.
Well, it's in there.
Okay.
Well, there's a lot of songs in there.
Well, there's two. There's Tiny Dancer, and then there's... I bet you'd recognize it.
I'm sure I would. Like I said, I know like the names of three of his songs, but if I heard them, I knew all the songs in the movie. I just didn't know that I knew them. I guess his songs.
It's when this song is when they go to New York for the first time, and because they're from England, obviously, and they're like, "Holy shit, people don't sleep here. Like this is crazy." Here, I'll play you. You know the song.
Yep.
It's in that movie.
Cool.
Almost Famous. That's one of my favorite songs with him. Anyway, I like their relationship. And I like that they never had a riff, really. Like Bernie, I guess they kind of did, but not.
Well, it wasn't like a big blowout or something. Bernie was just like, I need to take a break. We should do this together. And like. Get away, and Elton was like, fuck that.
They never said mean things that you can't take back to each other.
Yes. Yeah, didn't he say in that little rehab circle said that we only fought once?
No, he said they'd never had a fight.
I thought he said that they fought once, but it was nothing. Because they made a point to have the argument on stage, on the off stage, and he was screaming at him, then he walked away, and he turned back, touched his head, I'm sorry. He's like, I know.
He's in the circle thing. He said, we never really had a fight. And then at the end, it said, like, 50 years later, they still haven't had a fight.
Nice. Well, I mean, that was just, it's a beautiful friendship. Yeah, like, you just, like, say immediately.
I think there's a difference between like, a fight and an argument. They would argue, but they never, fought.
That's fair.
That's what I thought that was really nice. Like, they never, like, went to a place of no return and insulted each other.
Mm-hmm. Which it sounded like Elton did a lot of that with people.
I liked how they didn't make, like, his homosexuality the reason for all his troubles. Like, his troubles were his own. I don't think it was...
Yeah, he had to learn how to love himself, and part of that was, like, being a gay person in that time. But him being gay was never the problem.
No, like, everyone he told, like, even his mom, who was a bitch, she was still a bitch, but she was fine with him being gay.
Because she knew.
That kind of sums it up, kind of, that corny line she said, where, like, I don't care if you're gay, but you're never going to find love, and it was kind of because, like, he's got to work on himself first.
Yeah.
I also liked how they never made the partying seem, like, cool.
No, it seemed not fun, like, the entire time.
It wasn't like the Motley Crue movie where it was like, man, I'm jealous of this.
See, I thought that was me. I'm glad you guys are saying that, because I was watching this thing, and I was like, I would just be exhausted going to those friggin' parties.
For sure, and I think that's how you're supposed to feel, too, that, like, he was just doing this to, like, not have to sit there with his own thoughts. He's looking for a way to
just take a break. Sucks. It's a tough life.
There's a scene when he was married and he just pours the vodka and the orange juice.
Yeah.
And that was like a good way that the director of the movie, like, they were saying, like, it wasn't glamorous. He wasn't just drinking socially. Like, this was like gross. And the way his wife looks at him,
he never turned off.
He chugs it down and just says, sorry. Sorry, I'm an alcoholic. That's good. I thought all the musical numbers were wild.
Yeah. I especially liked the song at the end that they just recreated the music video.
Oh, yeah.
Catch up. I'm going to catch up. I can't remember.
Catch up late. Catch me up. I don't know what it is. But I've heard the song 1,000 times and I've seen the music video. And I just thought that was, like, perfect. Tearing up Edgerton's, like, face and, like, his actual smile. Like, this is the first time as an adult in the movie, too, he is smiling and it's not, like, a forced one for the stage.
Yeah, how sad was that? Looking in the mirror, like, practicing how to smile?
Yeah, or, like, all the times where he was, like, clearly miserable right off stage and then he puts the smile on as he walks out.
Mm-hmm. Part of his costume.
Yeah, not bad. Anything that you guys would have changed?
No, I mean, I was pretty happy with it.
I know you were. Looking back, I want to make a point that I wasn't like too heavy on the weird fantastical parts. It caught me off guard. Jimmy, you worded it correctly. Once it realized that it got settled in. If I watch it again, it'd be totally on board with it. I get it, but I was hoping for a little bit of a breakup to find out what was real and what wasn't. But that's the reason why this guy's making money and I'm not. So I
would like if they were to come out with another Elton John movie and it was more of like a walk the line, like this is a story. I'd be interested in that as well.
Yeah.
But I do think that they took like a huge risk.
Chance
and it paid off. My other question is this guy, he's in, you know him, Shane, you were shocked I'd never seen him before. What's his name?
Taron Egerton.
He was in Eddie the Eagle, which I'd never seen.
He was so good in that.
But that was
he put on a ton of weight.
That was the same director.
Yeah.
So he's perfect for Elton John, but it also seems like he's just this director's guy. Like, how did that work out so well?
Well, actually, because he's well known for the Kingsman movies.
Uh huh.
Yeah, those are like his bigger movies.
Yeah, and in the second one, the latest one, Elton John was like a hostage or held captive in that movie. So he
became friends.
I guess Taron, he went to like a music school and like for his audition, he sang Elton John's songs, one of them.
And like
so he was a big fan of it, and then he was like on set with him for this movie, and they just hit it off. So. And Elton was like, this guy has to be play me because he gets it.
Yeah, because that was actually Taron Egerton singing in the film. And like he's gone out on like, because Elton John's on his like last tour. So he's gone out on like every few, like not a ton of the stops, but for some of the stops, they'll perform like the songs together.
That's so cool.
Yeah, that is cool. That it's like nice of Elton. Have you ever seen all the videos of Elton John? If anyone listening hasn't seen, there's a video of him. He has the lyrics that Bernie wrote to Tiny Dancer, and he just puts them in front of him, just the words. And there's a camera crew when he's, like, working on the song, like, crafting it. And he's explaining, like, well, it looks like this word, it, everything needs to slow down a little. It looks like this is this. And then he just sings it. Like he just wrote it on the spot. That's how he did all his songs. It's crazy. There's another video where he's older and he's teaching the songwriting class. And they're like, yeah, I can make a melody out of anything. And he's like, does anyone have a book? And then he takes a book from the crowd, opens it to a random page, and just turns that like three lines into a song. It's crazy what he can do.
That's wild. I didn't know idea he was doing that until this movie.
Yeah, me neither.
Yeah, go watch some old Elton John YouTube videos. They're really, really cool. Talented.
Very talented. Yeah. I mean, that's scary talented. So he's like, what do they call it, a savant?
He could make melodies. He could put words to melodies like that.
But he can't write words.
He needs someone to write the words, but the music is all in his head.
He got lucky meeting that guy, Bernie.
That's perfect.
Real lucky.
Yeah, so did Bernie, though.
Yeah, Bernie really hit it off with him.
And it was funny. It was interesting when he said the whole part where he was like, I'm the one that can't walk the street. I'm the one that doesn't have a life anymore. Because your whole time you're thinking, man, I wonder if Bernie is upset because he doesn't get any of the credit for all this. You guys didn't even know he existed.
Mm-hmm.
And then that line comes and it's like, Bernie may be pretty happy to be able to live his life and still be rich.
Yeah, like he's still,
and have experiences too.
Seemingly rich, and then like he can go to the mall and not be swarmed.
He was always there too. So he had the experiences. He had the lifestyle. He had everything except for the oppressing fame.
Yeah, I wonder what his net worth is.
I'm gonna say $15 million.
150 mil. I mean, Elton John. Come on, man.
Elton John is billions, right?
I would guess.
I don't know.
I'll do 800 million.
Elton John. I mean, this is like CelebrityWorth.com, which you can't really trust. 500 million.
I'd give up that extra $350 million to like still be filthy
to be anonymous.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right, let's go on to rankings. Ratings.
Okay.
Popcorn is entertainment wise, just entertainment. Were you glued to your seat? Not gonna walk away. Do you wanna rewatch it? All that stuff. I'll go first and I'm going with an easy 5. I realized what the movie was. I was so into it. I was really into it. So I'm going 5.
Nice. Yeah, I'm also going 5. I love this movie. I'm definitely going to watch it again. I'll watch it with family. Okay. Anytime I see it on TV, I feel like I'll at least stay for like a musical number.
Yeah, I guess not that it matters because our official score will be a 5, but I'll bring it to a 4.5 because I just had something off about it where I can't, like, I got other movies where I'm like, boom, this is great for me. Great. This one had a little bit off. 4.5.
4.5. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
What's this movie called? Rocket Man?
No.
All right. So she ends with a 4.5.
Mm-hmm.
I'm at a 5. Dave's at a 5. What about Critical? You want to go first then, John?
Sure. It was excellent. It was visually stunning. The acting was great, except for the side characters. I'll give it a 85.
85.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh.
Oh, yeah?
Dave, what do you got?
I've been raving about the movie the entire time, so I'm not just going to hit the same points now, but I'm giving it a 92.
Wow. Cool. I was at an 88.
Look at that.
Nice.
That's might be the smallest window we've had in a while. We were
in
all
a while, yes. I think there was one movie where we were all like within 5 points.
Yeah.
That's so that leaves us at an 88.3. This is gonna be up there for us, I think.
I think it really is. We don't have many in the '90s.
Wow. Okay.
I know you do.
Let's see where it falls. I'm happy with the way that rounds out.
So am I.
It's basically my score, so. You guys were right above me in bowling. No, okay, so what did I say, Atlanta? 88?
88 point something.
Yeah, 88.3.
Why can't I find it? I don't know.
I don't know, man.
88.3 puts it above puts it right above Incredibles 2 and tied with Christopher Robin.
Okay.
Ooh.
Fair.
Disaster like Artist is above it. Avengers Endgame is below it.
Hmm.
Rotten Tomatoes. Okay, works. What do you guys think the scores are? Let's start with critics.
Critics are going to love this movie.
Yeah, let's go. Critics score 92?
90. I don't know how high they get, but I think
they go up to 100.
I know, but how high do the critics ever really get?
This is at a 90, so you were right.
90, okay.
Critically. And audience, what do you think the audience is at?
That's really tough. Shit. Because I can see some people being like, that was weird.
But I think you guys only found it weird because you didn't watch the the trailers were very much, it was like a fantastical element to this movie.
That might be fair. I'll go with similar. Go with 92 again.
Yeah, 88. Exactly what I gave it.
It was an 88.
Ah.
That's crazy. So the critical and... How often does that happen? Where the critics on Rotten Tomatoes and the populace?
I mean, for good movies, often.
Yeah, I feel like now that they're cracking down on scores too, they're evening out.
They've just revamped their whole like audience thing, where you actually have to like submit a picture of the ticket to prove you actually saw it.
Not these clowns just saying like because, it like, sucks for just for the hell
of it. There was a lot of bots just flooding things.
On IMDb, it's got a 7.7.
Okay. So,
what's it on Metacritic? That's the one I like.
Can I bring back an oldie for us, by the way?
Yeah.
What are you guys going to drink with this?
Oh, wow, that is an oldie.
Mm-hmm. We haven't done a pairing in forever.
NyQuil.
Cocaine.
You can't drink cocaine.
You can if you try hard enough.
Okay. I'm going to go with a nice tall glass of vodka with a little bit of orange juice.
Oh, nice. Like what he drank in the movie.
Mm-hmm. When his life was at its rock bottom.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you gotta celebrate it.
I think you missed the message.
Just saying, guys. There was a drink involved. We talked about it. I'm gonna bring it back. That's how this works.
I have a question for y'all, though.
What?
If Ben Affleck was in this movie, who should he have played?
Ah, he would have been a better Rob Stark.
Yeah, the Rob Stark guy, for sure.
See, but I like that guy, that actor. I'm forgetting his name. He's also in The Bodyguard.
Oh, he could be good, but I mean,
I thought he was good. Could be better. I thought him being like the same age or near enough to Taron Egerton like made sense that they were romantically linked. Where if like Ben Affleck was in that role, it'd feel super creepy as like this older predator.
If I had to go with a B for Ben Affleck, I would go with the father.
I could see
he could play distant.
Oh yeah,
he could play distant for sure.
Just play himself.
He's a good father.
You don't know that.
I do know that. All right,
I'm going with John Reed.
John Reed,
that's the guy.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right, cool. That ends this. Is there anything else we have to do?
No,
I think we're good.
That covers it.
We all enjoyed the movie. We're all pretty similar, so that's cool.
Yep.
This is just like a really positive recording.
Yeah, very, very.
I tried to find something I didn't like with it. It didn't really stick. So,
very interesting. All right, we have an entire back catalog. I think this was like the 80-something movie we've reviewed, 85th. So if you want to go listen to find some other movies or TV shows that you've enjoyed and hear what we had to say and how we rated those, go to our back catalog now. Otherwise, every Friday we put out Hollywood Headliners, in which we talk about the headlines that are floating around Hollywood. If you couldn't, if you could not figure it out yourself, instead of playing our regular outro music, I'm going to play Mona Lisa's and Mad Hatters.
Why not?
Do it.
Because
love
really
y'all.
All right. Check us out next week. We're gonna review Late Night.
Late Night next Friday. Go see it.
Monday.
We'll see you then.
Next Monday.
It'll be there.
Come
on. One day it'll be there.
All right.
See ya.
Later. Until you see. This trash can dream come true. You stand at the edge while people run you through. And I thank the Lord there's people out there like you. I thank the Lord there's people out there like you.
lawyers turn around and say good morning to the night. For unless they see the sky, but they can't, and that is why.